Hello, my name is Jayesh Kumar Sharma and I am your instructor for this course, for this session, that is on how to prevent from being a victim of cybercrime. So in the rapid technology change, cybercrime has also changed. It has become a profession now, and demography of the cyber criminal changes very rapidly. So it is very difficult to trace and identify cyber criminals until you are having a foolproof system to track their activities. Four types of entities are working in every cybercrime. These are coders, kits, drops or mopes. So we will see the activities of each and every entity here in cyber criminal activities. So first we will discuss the activities of coders in cybercrime. Basically, coders are developing and producing ready to use tools such as Trojan horse, mailers, custom bots or other services which will be used for conducting cybercrime. These tools are made available online so that other entities can download it or make use of these tools. Tools are made for cybercrime labor force, that is called kits. That is the second entity in this hierarchy. So coders are basically developing the tools and making it available to the cybercrime labor force. Basically, cybercrime labor force is the force who is conducting actual cybercrimes, and that force is referred as kits. That is the second entity in this hierarchy. So cybercrime labor force is referred as the kits. Why it is called kits? Because most of the stakeholders are under 18. These people download online tools or buy them or trade or resell the elementary building blocks of effective cyber scam. It may be spam list, it may be mailers, it may be proxies, credit card numbers, hacked host and many more. So coders are developing the tools. These tools are being downloaded or purchased by the kits, who is the actual workforce behind cybercrime. Third category is drops. These drops are basically some individuals who are converting the virtual money obtained in cybercrime into real cash. So if some online fraud is being conducted, then virtual money is being transferred to the account. So how to encash that virtual money? So it is encashed through drops. So basically they are converting virtual money into real cash. These people are usually located in countries where cybercrime laws are relaxed. And lastly, in this hierarchy, we have mobs. Basically, these are professionally operating criminal organizations who are making use of all other three stakeholders, whether coder, kits, or drops. So it combines all the above functions, and they make good use of drops, and they also recruit coders on their payroll. Now in this section we will see what are the precautions to be taken for not being a victim of cybercrime. Basically, we will discuss some do's and don'ts on the internet. So the first precaution is use a strong password. When we talk about password, we must remember three things. We must change our password frequently. We must maintain different password for each and every site, and we must use complex passwords. So we see details of each and every point. When we talk about change your password frequently, then it's a common tendency by the user that they don't change their password frequently. If a password has been set a year back, then it will be same even after 2 or 3 years. So you must change this mindset, and you must frequently change your password. You can change it periodically, once in 15 days or in month. Financial institutions like banks in India have made it mandatory to change your password after 15 days or after 1 month. As per Government of India policy, it is mandatory to change your password after a certain period of time. When we talk about the second point, set different password for each site, it has been observed that many people use same password on each and every site. They maintain the same password. So if one account is hacked, all accounts are probable to be hacked. So it is advised that always use different password for each site. Now it might be difficult for the user to remember all passwords on different sites. So a pattern can be defined which is end user specific, which suits you for having a different password policy. The third point under strong password is make complex password. As per the survey conducted on the internet, it was identified that there are some common passwords, and these common passwords were 123456, 123456789, password ABC123, 12345, I love you. So these are some common passwords which are used by the users. And if you are having these passwords, then there is a probability that you are going to be a victim of cybercrime, because these passwords can be easily broken. So always use complex or strong passwords. Now, how to choose a strong password? What are the requirements of a strong password? It should have at least 8 to 10 characters, numbers or symbols. If you can give more characters, it will be better. A mixture of both uppercase and lowercase letter should be there. A mixture of letter and number should be there. At least one special character should be included. So when we talk about strong password use, we must take care of password complexity, password change frequently, and different password for each site. Second precaution is manage social media settings. So when you are online on any social media platform, you must be very careful. You must maintain your social media settings. On social media platform, there are few points to be remembered. You should keep your personal and private information locked. Many users keep all information open, and when their profile is visited, visitors know each and everything about the user. What is the family background, who are the friends, who are the relatives, different types of photographs, their date of birth, likes, dislikes, everything is available on the internet. So you can go through any user on the social media platform, and then you will find that these all informations are available. In personal life, in actual life, we don't tell these things to strangers. When we are not telling everything to the strangers in real life, then why are we telling all this information on the social media? We must be very careful that selected amount of information should be made public on the social media. If you are providing every information on the social media, then there is a probability that you might be a victim of profile impersonation. Profile impersonation means on your behalf, someone else will make an account on the social media platform and pretend to be some other person. For profile impersonation or fake profile, information will be required, and you are providing each and every information through your actual profile. So you must choose appropriate privacy level. You should note that on social media platform, appropriate privacy level is maintained by you. This diagram shows how to change the privacy level. You have to go to the privacy settings, and then you have to change the settings. Who can visit your profile, who can view your photographs, who can view your friend list. So you can change the target audience of the post, pictures and your profile. Another important point on social media platform is never post your relationships on social media. Many times on Facebook we see that people post their relationship with other Facebook users, that some other person is mother or wife or husband or son. So these types of relationship you should not provide on social media. If you are providing these relationship on social media, that means you are publicizing your secret questions related to bank or other password. You might have seen that when you change your password in net banking and when you make online transactions, sometimes it asks for secret questions. And most of the time secret questions are like, what is your pet's name? What is your mother's name? And similar information. So if you are providing relationship detail on the social media, then you are publicizing these secret questions, and there is a probability that hackers or the criminals may find their answer from your social media post. So criminals may also use this information to gain undue benefit from your bank accounts. One more important thing, don't put date of birth publicly. It feels very good when you receive birthday wishes or anniversary wishes on social media platform from number of people, but you are doing at the cost of publicizing your most private information, that is date of birth. Everywhere date of birth is used as a key value for performing limited or personal operations. So bank account transactions or updates are also linked with date of birth, which we make public on the social media platform. Password reset activities are made easier for the criminals by publicizing our date of birth. So keep in mind, don't publicize your date of birth, keep it private. Be careful about social media status. It's a common tendency of the Facebook users to change their status. We might go through certain status traveling to, let us say, New Delhi, or checked in at IGI Airport, New Delhi. So changing status means you are telling each and everything about yourself to the criminals. Criminal may take a note of this, and they come to know that either your home is empty or there are very few people at the home because you are at the IGI airport or you are at some other place. So don't provide such status which are reducing your confidentiality. Always keep it confidential. There is no need to post such sort of status. Another important point in social media is about posting of photos or snaps. Think twice before posting your photographs. People have tendency to post each and everything related to their visit, related to their personal life on the Facebook and Twitter or Instagram accounts. And there is a probability that they are going to be a victim of cybercrime. So they must think twice before sending or before posting these pictures on the online platform, because these photographs can be morphed, videos can be edited, and your photograph can make strangers rich. There is a case study. A syndicate was there in Malaysia who used to make full use of such photographs, particularly of Asian girls, and used their photographs as a call girl service on Facebook without even their information. So it's a very common practice on the Facebook and social media platform that your pictures are being copied, they are being edited, pictures are being edited, videos are being edited, and it is being used somewhere else for some other purpose, and you may not be aware about that. Apart from that, we have also heard that college girls are harassed by morphing their photograph taken from social media platform. So whenever you are posting such photographs, always be careful. Choose appropriate visibility status. Whether visibility status means whether it will be posted to friends, friends of friends, only you, or it will be made public. Never make it public. Like in this diagram, you can say number of options are there. You can choose your audience, whether you want to make your photograph public or you want to make it available to your friends, then specific friends or only me. So never make it public because some other person who are not in your friend list make use of that photographs. Another precaution that we must take, that is use of licensed antivirus. We have a common practice to use downloaded antivirus, that is free of cost antivirus. We install that antivirus on the system and we forget that these free antiviruses are not updated after a particular time. So always use licensed antivirus. If you are performing e-commerce operations or the net banking operations from your laptop or your desktop, then your system or the computer system must have licensed antivirus. And don't forget to update antivirus periodically. So always it should be enabled and regular updates should be available on the antivirus. Similarly, your applications should be updated. Now, what do you mean by applications? Application basically refers to the operating system and some other applications which are helping in the security of applications. So keep your operating system updated. Many times it happens that operating system is being updated, so user gets frustrated and they put off this feature. That means Windows or operating system updates will never be downloaded. You should not do that, because operating system updates are basically security patches which makes your operating system secure. What is the need of operating system updates? Because cyber criminals frequently use known flaws or exploits in the software and app to gain access to the system. So operating system helps in filling those gaps and flaws. So if you have disabled your operating system update, then there is a possibility that these exploits will never be filled and hackers or cyber criminals may enter into your system. So patching those exploits and flaws can protect you from being a cybercrime victim. So it may include operating system updates or security patches, or it may include mobile software updates or security patch. So never disable those updates, because these updates are protecting you from the cybercrime. Another precaution is increase security of home network. So your home network should be secure from where you are connecting your internet. It has been seen number of times that people use Wi-Fi at home and access point or router is not properly configured and they allow open access to each and everyone. So it should not happen. It should be secure enough so that security is provided at the access point level. So if you are using Wi-Fi at home, use strong encryption password or use strong encryption method. If possible, use VPN whenever using Wi-Fi at a public place. Public Wi-Fis are quite common nowadays in cafes, at airport, at railway station. You may find public Wi-Fis. So when you are using public Wi-Fis, you can use VPN. VPN stands for Virtual Private Network. VPN encrypts all traffic leaving your device until it arrives at its destination. So this data is not accessible to cyber criminals and it is not visible to cyber criminals. So don't leave Wi-Fi option open for all. There is one common mistake which is made by the user, that if one access point is open, it will be kept open for number of days. So if your work is over, keep your Wi-Fi off. So when not using it, switch it off, because someone else may try to gain access of this Wi-Fi system or the access point and they may break the encryption standards. One most important precaution in cyber security is secure use of cards. Whether you are using ATM cards or debit card or credit card, you must use these cards very carefully. To steal money from your card, criminal needs two things. First thing is the information contained in the magnetic strip of your card. You might have seen the magnetic black strip in the card that contains the private information about the user and the card. And the second is your PIN. So if these two things are available to the criminal, then they can steal your money from the card. So how do they obtain this information? Basically, three devices are used to steal this information or to obtain this information about the card. The first device is skimmer. Skimmers are the devices that read the information contained in magnetic strip on the card. They are attached above the card slot on an ATM. When someone inserts their card, their data is transferred by the skimmer to the criminal's electronic device. Basically, a skimmer device is put on the actual card slot in the ATM machine, and user doesn't know whether they are passing their card through a skimmer. So when a card is passed through that skimmer, the complete information of the card is copied into the electronic device or the criminal's electronic device. So how to trace it? So you can see this diagram. In this first diagram, you can see a skimmer has been attached to the actual ATM slot. Now in second diagram, a difference has been shown between real card slot and the fake card slot. In real card slot, you can see only card slot is visible, but in case of fake card slot, an additional skimmer has been put on the actual card slot and the shape of the card slot has changed. So if you are observing something unusual in ATM card slot, so try to pull that device. So if it is a skimmer, it will be come out. The second device which is used for obtaining the information is hidden cameras. So hidden cameras are used in with the skimmers to make a video of your PIN. Camera may be placed at number of locations. It may be on the ATM itself, like near the keypad or above the screen, or it may be nearby ATM machine. So sometimes they are so small that they can be hidden in a tiny opening on the ATM and you can't even see that there will be a camera. So using this camera, cyber criminals basically try to access information about your PIN. So whenever you are typing your PIN, important precaution, whether you are alone in the ATM machine, don't think you are alone, because there might be a possibility that hidden camera is there. So whenever you are typing your password, hide it with your hand, so that even if there is a camera or hidden camera in the ATM, it is not recorded in the electronic device of the cyber criminal. Now you can see in this diagram, is showing an ATM machine attached with hidden camera. Now it is so small that we even can't imagine and see that a camera has been installed in this ATM machine. This arrow is indicating that in this particular hole, a camera has been installed, hidden camera is there. The third device which is used to capture the PIN information is covered plate over keypad, and it is also referred as fake keypad, which is also used to record your PIN number. Basically, fake keypad is put on the actual keypad, and whenever you press any button on the fake keypad, it is recorded in the electronic device attached with this fake keypad. So how to trace this, whether the keypad is fake or not? So you can try to push the up area or the up corner or the left corner of the keypad. If it is fake keypad, it will be visible. So using this method, you can find the fake keypad or fake skimmer on the machine. Now these are certain guidelines about secure use of card. Always use a card with a chip installed. So skimmers copy the information contained in the magnetic strip. So if you are using a card with chip, then there is a probability that this information will not be copied through the skimmer. So Government of India has made it compulsory for all the cards to be chip based card, and banks have already replaced their cards with chip based cards. Always cover the keypad with your hands when you are typing the PIN number. This will prevent a hidden camera from recording it. As I said earlier, never think you are alone in the ATM machine room. Always hide your password with your hand. Always use ATM machines where guards are available. There are number of ATM machines in India which are at remote locations. Security guards are not available, so try to avoid those ATMs. Always use ATMs where security guards are available, because there is a less probability of using skimmer and hidden cameras in such ATMs. Limit the area where you use your card. You should not always use every ATM available in the country. Try to limit your area where you are using your card. If you are aware that a particular ATM is secure enough to use your card, always try to use your card on the same ATM machine. Usage limit on the credit card amount. This can be set very easily on the credit card, so that if any cybercrime happens with the credit card, the limited amount of loss is recorded. People maintain credit cards with huge amount of credit limit. So before using credit card, a expense limit should be defined properly. So let us assume if I am having a credit card with 1.5 lakh credit limit, then by default it is open. That means any person having a credit card can spend 1.5 lakhs. So I must provide a expense limit. So let us say 10,000. So if I provide this limit, then any user who is having my credit card and the details, they will be able to make a purchase of only 10,000. So I can limit my loss. So always provide some limits with your credit card, so that if it is compromised, limited loss is there. And the most important precaution, don't give your card to anyone. It's a common tendency at the petrol pump or restaurant that we provide our card to the person available there. They swipe in these cards and ask for PIN. Then they bring the machine. So in the meantime, there is a possibility that they might have skimmers and they can copy the complete information. And when you are typing your PIN number, they can view that PIN. They can make a clone of that card and can be misused. Very important point, don't be greedy. Use your common sense. If you are using your common sense over internet or social media platform, you will not be a victim of email scam or phishing. Basically, email scam or phishing refers to the emails which promise you to give the amount of money, a prize money or lottery or checks or some other payments. They ask for some money in the name of tax or processing charges. As soon as the money is transferred, they stop talking. You can find number of emails in your inbox that invite people to have some sexual relationship or to view some obscene videos or photographs by clicking on the given link in the email. So never click on these links, because these links are malware or viruses. As soon as you click on the link, a malware will be installed on the system and the complete information will be transmitted to the hacker system. So always try to follow these points. Delete unsolicited emails. If you are receiving such mails, always delete those emails. Don't believe false promises of money or prizes. If you are getting any email that you have won some prize or you have won some money or money is being transferred to your account, never trust these emails. Question, request for donation. It has been seen number of times when there is a natural disaster in the country, many organizations say that on behalf of government they are asking for donation. So always you must ask on whose behalf they are requesting for the donation, and always give donation to the genuine account rather than fake accounts. There are many fake accounts who claim to receive donation on behalf of government organizations. So you must trace it properly before donating to the organizations. Don't click any link given in email. Most important thing, if you are going to click any link, then you are going to be a victim of cybercrime until it is from legitimate source. Don't open email coming from unknown email IDs. Always avoid these emails. Mark unwanted emails as spam regularly. Though email services are also doing this service automatically, but our inbox is sometimes filled with some unwanted mails. So always regularly mark these unwanted mails as spam. If you want to check the authenticity of any email, then check headers of that email so that you can come to know about the authenticity of the email. There are a lot of e-commerce sites available on cyberspace who claim to provide the cheapest material to the end consumer. So people search any material on the internet and they land to a site which is not authentic, which is not secure enough, and they make purchase on that particular site. As soon as they make a purchase on that site because of less price or free offers or sudden offers given by a site, there is a high probability that they are going to be a victim. So keep in mind, whenever you are making an online purchase, shop on authentic sites, shop on secure sites. That means secure site means it should start with HTTPS rather than HTTP. Another important point with online purchase, whenever a purchased material is delivered at home, before opening the parcel, make a video. That means whenever you are opening that parcel, create a video or make a video of that process, because many sites make a fraud and they send wrong material to the consumer. So this video will help you in suing the company. Now these guidelines are related to safe banking transactions. Net banking is quite common nowadays. Everybody is having net banking account and they are performing online transactions. So whenever you are performing online transactions, certain guidelines must be followed. If you are following these guidelines, there is a probability that you will be safe. So these guidelines are: always type name of URL, don't click given links in email. Let us assume I receive a mail from XYZ bank that we are updating your record, kindly click on the following link and update your account. So if I have to update my account, what I will do, I will not click that URL. I will type that URL in browser and then I will go to the bank website, because there is a probability that it may be a forged URL. It may redirect me to some other website where I will be providing my information. So always type URL when you are performing the banking transactions. Never go to banking website through a link, because email may be forged. Apart from that, if it is possible to use virtual keypad, it will be safer. You might have seen virtual keypad with each and every net banking site. Virtual keypads basically avoids keyloggers. Keyloggers are the softwares which trace your key logging activities and they keep track of or the record of every character which you type on the keyboard. So there is a probability that keylogger is installed on the machine. So always use virtual keypad, especially if you are using net banking from the public system, or never type your password on the public systems. After performing your operations, you must log out properly from the net banking site. Never share your account number or ATM pin or net banking credentials with anyone. And if someone says that they are bank official and they want this information, then keep in mind bank officials never ask for this information, especially ATM pins and net banking passwords. There is a probability that even after so many precautions, a payment is done without your consent. The payment may be done from credit card or net banking or from your bank account without your consent. Then what to do? Then immediately report to your bank or the card service provider company and hotlist your card or block your card. Another important concern about cyber security is: be careful when you meet online. Online chat, online discussion forums, online friend requests, these are very common things through which we meet online people. But people you meet online are not always who they claim to be. Profile impersonation or fake profiles might be there, which are quite common in practice. These may be honey trap cases, which are quite common for trapping especially defense or government officials. Fake social media profiles are used to meet unwary web users and pick their cyber pockets. Basically, casual web users are general target of these social media profiles or fake media profiles. So be cautious and sensible in your online life as you are in your personal social life. So if you are not meeting unknown people in your personal life, then try to avoid this meeting in online life also. Practice safe browsing. Whenever you are browsing on the internet using your computer system or laptop, you must not visit suspected sites. Now, how to identify suspected sites? Sometimes Google also indicates that this site is not appropriate to be visited. So always avoid to visit those sites. Always look for HTTPS rather than HTTP, especially if you are performing banking transactions or financial transactions, or you are entering some username and password. Always keep in mind that it should be HTTPS rather than HTTP, because if you are using HTTP, it will be transmitted as it is over the internet and it will be visible to the cyber criminals. So always use HTTPS for financial transactions, for net banking transactions, or username password whenever you are providing. Keep in mind, one careless click over internet could expose personal data or infect your device with malwares. Sometimes users lower down their security setting in order to view certain images or videos. Never do that. If you are doing this, your system is going to be compromised. Important point, talk to your children about the internet. Most of the target in cybercrime are children, because they are not aware about the practices, they are not about the cyber crimes, they are not aware about the trends. So teach your kids about acceptable use of internet or mobile devices. Always communicate with them. Don't shut down communication channel with children. So if they are having any problem, they must be able to communicate it with you frankly. Ask them to discuss in case they are experiencing any kind of online harassment, cyber stalking or cyber bullying. So if they are victim of cyber bullying or cyber stalking, which is quite common in school and colleges, they should feel free to discuss with you so that this problem could be handled properly. Teach them not to indulge in any cyber crime activity. Since children are not aware about cyber laws or cyber crime activities, so unintentionally they may indulge themselves in cyber crime activities. So it is the responsibility of the parents to teach them what are cyber crime activities and what are not. So they must be taught about the cyber crime activities and cyber laws so that they are not a part of cyber crime and they are not a victim also. Teach them what cyber crime is, what to do and what not to do on internet. They may not be knowing this. So it is our responsibility to teach them how to use internet safely. Finally, even after so many precautions, if you are a victim of cybercrime, then what to do? If you have become a victim of cybercrime, it should be immediately reported with the district cyber cell, which is available at every district headquarter. If crime is related to bank, immediately inform to bank authorities. And if it is related to card, then ask your bank to block that card. In this session, we have seen how do we define cybercrime? What are the different classification of cybercrimes against individual property, against government, against organizations, against society? What are the different crimes which are conducted in each and every category that we have seen? It may be harassment, it may be dissemination of obscene material, cyber stalking, cyber bullying, defamation, indecent exposure, online cheating, online frauds, email spoofing, phishing, transmission of viruses. So these all are cyber crimes which are most commonly performed. Apart from that, we also identify that how cyber criminals are working and who are involved in these cyber criminal activities. So we identified the role of coders, kids, drops and mobs in cyber criminal activities. And based on the background of cyber crime and how cyber crime is performed, we saw the prevention techniques so that we are not a victim of cybercrime. Now these practices may include strong passwords, proper use of social media. So on social media, we should be careful, updated applications, licensed antivirus, security of home network, secure use of cards, then online purchase from authentic sites, safe banking transactions and safe browsing practices. I hope this session is useful for you and you will follow these guidelines so that you are not a victim of cybercrime activities. Thank you.